الكريم ولا تركنوا إلى الذين ظلموا فتمسكم النار وما لكم من دون الله من أولياء ثم لا تنصرون صلوات الله. In tonight's Thursday night program, which normally is brief, but also keeping in mind the current situation that we are going through, I would like to talk about one of the common questions that I've been getting these days, and that is about the issue of dealing with Israeli products and companies. For example, on the website of the Grand Ayatollah Sistani, in the Arabic version, in Farsi and English, I didn't check the Urdu one. There are these questions and his responses have been there from many, many years. This is nothing new. Where basically, you know, for example, one question was, and in the English part here it says, I know there is a company which is helping Israel monthly, on a monthly basis. What is the fatwa about working in such a company and purchasing its products? And the answer given there is that it is not permissible to deal with Israeli products and products of companies which are known to be supporting Israel in an effective way. So the mas'ala is nothing new. Sometimes, you know, in the social media, or you see, oh, new fatwa of Ayatollah Sistani, or Sistani has said this. This has been there for many, many years. There's nothing new. Let me just, you know, emphasize on two points here. Number one, if you look at the emphasis that he has in the English version where he says, and this is there also in Arabic also, in an effective way. When I get the question, people already have been getting these in the social media and in emails, a long list of companies and products. Basically, what it means is that everything is haram. And you have to be careful about it. Ayatollah Sistani is emphasizing on the point of where a company is supporting Israel in an effective way, or if I may replace that with actively. What it means is that not that a company which is doing business in Israel, you're not allowed to buy the products of that company. Which major company of the West does not do business in Israel? That even in traveling in planes, Boeing or Airbus will become haram. Not only that, even using the computers by which you send all these lists to people around, using that tool will become haram. So the issue is not whether the company works with Israel or has a branch there. The issue is that, is there a company, can you identify the owner or the company which actively gives donation to the state of Israel? Or for example, you know, promotes the programs of settlers going into occupied land, you know, which are all, you know, even according to international law, they are illegal, what they do. So if you know that there is a company which is actively donating and supporting the state of Israel, then its products will become haram, to deal with it will become haram. You know, not that every company which deals with Israel becomes haram. The second thing is that the marja responds to a question. He doesn't give you the list of companies and products. You know, people take that fatwa on one side and then they add this whole list of products with it, as if it is coming from the office of Ayatollah Sistani or other marja. No, that's not the case. It is your duty to go and do the research, and once you find out, and it's not difficult, you know, you can do that, and, you know, then you would have to refrain from it. Is the masala clear here? Salawat for the Akbarar. What is the basis, shari'i, religious basis of this fatwa, or this kind of fatwa? There is nothing new. This is not a new ijtihad. In the Shi'i fiqh from day one, there is a concept known as i'anatu dhalama, which means helping the oppressors. This concept has been there in the Shi'i fiqh from the days of the Imams, alayhimus salam. And they have strongly asked the Shias that you have to refrain from any job or any business dealing where you become the tool of the oppressors. And this is termed as i'anatu dhalama. And so there's a whole discussion about whether you are allowed to work for the government or not. Amal al-Sultan, this is jaiz or haram. And this became a very serious issue when soon during the early era of the Ghibatis Kubra, when Ali Buya came to power. Ali Buya were the ministers from Ali Buya family, which were Shia. They became powerful in Baghdad, and the Khalifa during those days became like a puppet. And some of our Shia ulama were kind of cooperating with Ali Buya, you know, government. And so this question came up. And this is the days of Sayyid Murtaza, brother of Sayyid Rizvi, who compiled Nahj al-Balagha. And Sayyid Murtaza was a prominent mujtahid of the time. He ended up writing a risala, extensive, you know, article, essay on this issue. Where it is allowed, where it is not allowed. What are the conditions where you can work with a, you know, a government which is not legitimate from the Shari'i point of view? Where you have to refrain. So this is not something which is new. This has been there. And so any trade or business or profession that involves i'anatu dhalama, helping the oppressor, is forbidden and considered to be one of the major sins. One way where we identify a major sin is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran relates the sin to the fire of Jahannam. And when it comes to i'anatu dhalama, there is an ayat from Surah Hud, Surah number 11, ayat 113, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَرْكُنُوا إِلَى الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا. Do not be inclined towards those who are unjust. Remember the word of choice, you know, the choice of words here by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا تَرْكُنُوا, you know, rukun here. Do not be inclined towards those who are unjust. Otherwise, what will happen? لَتَمَسَّكُمُ النَّارِ. You know, the fire will hold you, get you, touch you. So the issue of fire is being related to this issue of being inclined towards those who are zalimeen and unjust. And so we have this ayat of Quran, and based on that, you know, we have this concept of the hurmat of i'anatu dhalama. You cannot cooperate and support those who are obviously the unjust ones. Of course, there is a, you know, very extensive jurisprudential discussion about it. What are the cases where it's allowed? The examples we have even from the days of the Imams, where they would allow some of their companions to work with the government, and some they would refuse. They would say, you are not capable of handling this situation. And so this is where we have to realize that, you know, this is nothing new. And so when you hear this kind of fatwa, basically it's saying that dealing with any company that effectively supports Israel, you know, by dedicating, for example, a percentage of its profit to the state of Israel, or supporting its illegal settlements in the occupied territory, is definitely and absolutely haram. Salawat Pranay Akbar. Let me share with you an example, just for this short majlis, about the seriousness of this issue. An example from the days of the Imam. You know, we have a companion of the sixth and the seventh Imam by the name of Safwãn al-Jammãl. He's a very prominent Sahabi. We know him, you know, every Thursday night we recite Ziyarate Waris. You know who is the narrator of that? It's Safwãn al-Jammãl. He's known as, you know, his full name is something else. First name is Safwãn, but he's popularly known as al-Jammãl. Al-Jammãl is from Jamal. Jamal means camel. You know, these days you have this car rental business. Those days you didn't have a car. But similar business where he would be renting out his horses and camels for the people, you know, for their own purpose. And that's why he was called al-Jammãl, from Jamal. Or when you say Misam al-Tammar, another companion of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Tamar means debt. Tammar means somebody whose business is to buy and sell khurma. And so, you know, just in, for example, in Bombay, we have many Shias also, and Bohris and Muslims. Some of them are known by their profession, Batli Wala, you know, Mewa Wala, and all these, you know. So Wala is basically, that is the profession of that, you know, that person. So al-Jammãl here is his profession. But he was not only a businessman, very much trusted by Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam, that Ziyarat-e-Waris from the sixth Imam has reached to us through him. He's the one who requested. And many, many ahadith, very learned person also. During the days of the seventh Imam, when Hãrũn al-Rashīd was the Khalifa, a tyrant ruler of the time, one day, Safwãn al-Jammãl came to visit Imam Musa al-Kazim alayhi salatu wa salam. He sat down, and Imam looked at him. Imam says, Ya Safwãn, kull shay'in minka hasanun jameel, ma khala shay'in wahidin. O Safwãn, everything is good about you, except one thing. Remember, he's sitting there in front of the Imam Masum, not a Maulana. Huh? And if the Imam says, everything is good about you except this one issue, you have to seriously think about it. And so Safwãn says, Ja'altu fidak, ayyu shayin huwa. O Imam, may my life be sacrificed for you. What is that one point that you consider to be a problematic for me? And Imam says, Ikra'uka jamalika, jamalika min hadha rajul. He says, you know, renting your camels to this man, referring to Hãrũn al-Rashīd. Safwãn, like any one of us, you always would like to justify, well, you know, the circumstances were different. So he tries to explain. He says, Wallahi ma akraytuhu ashiran wala bataran wala lis-sayd wala lil-lahw. He says to the Imam, by Allah, I did not rent these camels out to him for his arrogance or adventure seeking, you know, trip, or for hunting or for entertainment. Walakin lihadha tariq, yani tariq Makkah. He says, no, Hãrũn wanted to go for Umrah or Hajj. But he was going from Makkah. And you know, when the kings travel, it's a huge entourage. They don't have the animals all the time. So they have to hire from others. And so he said he was going to Makkah, not for hunting or other business or warfare or anything like that. And so I rented out, وَلَا أَتَوَلَّاهُ بِنَفْسِي. Furthermore, he says, just to justify his decision, he says, وَلَا أَتَوَلَّاهُ بِنَفْسِي وَلَكِنْ عَبَثُ مَعَى غُلْمَانِ. I did not go with my animals in that trip with him. Rather, I sent my employees and workers. And this is where, you know, Imam looked at him. Ya Safwãn, أَيَقَوْ كِرَاكَ عَلَيْهِمْ. O Safwãn, is the rental for your animals still due to you from them? He said, of course. And then Imam asked him, أَتُحِبُّ بَقَاؤُهُمْ حَتَّى يَخْرُجُ كِرَاكُ. Do you want him to be alive until he comes back and gives you the rental money? Imam knows your mind and heart, huh? You can't play around. So Safwan says, Naam. And this is where Imam says, Man ahabba baqa'ahum fahuwa minhum. Whoever wishes for them to live even for one more day, he is from among them. وَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْهُمْ فَهُوَ وَارِدُ النَّارِ. And when he is with them, then he is going to go into Jahannam with them. And when the Imam says that, it's a very serious issue. So what does Safwan do? Immediately he went, he couldn't go to Hãrũn and said, you know, our deal is canceled, give me my animals back. He actually sold his business to somebody else. Now Safwan was not an ordinary person. People knew him, even Hãrũn knew him. When he heard that Safwan has sold his business to somebody else, you know, he sent him. He says, I heard this, that you sold your business. He said, yes. أنا شيخ كبير وإن الغلمان لا يفون بالعمال. I become old, I can't take the care of my business, and the workers are not really efficient, and so I just sold it. Hãrũn always suspected him to be Shi'a. He was in Taqiyya in a way. He says, Hayhat, Hayhat. I definitely know who told you to not make deal with me. Ashara alayka Musa bin Ja'far. You must have been listening to Musa bin Ja'far. And Safwan, you know, as if he pretends, he says, who is Musa bin Ja'far? I don't know him. And this is what Hãrũn says, just because of our, you know, long relationship, I'm letting you go. Otherwise, I would have killed you for that. Salawat upon the Quran. And this is where we come to realize that when we talk about this issue of اعانة الظلمة, you know, dealing with those who are oppressors, this is part of our teachings from day one. This is one example just I wanted to share with you about somebody, you know, we benefit from his ziyarat waris every Thursday night. And this is where you come to realize that, you know, people go through different challenges. And if you realize you are losing in one way, Allah will open many more doors for you. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهِ يَخْرَجِ اللَّهُ مَخْرَجًا. Whoever fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, gives up one opportunity, Allah will find a way for him out of his problems. So that, you know, consciousness of Allah's being is important, even when we talk about business dealings and what is halal and what is haram. Salawat upon the Quran. Let me end with a reminder of one statement from Amir al-Mu'mineen between the Zarbat and Shahadat. There is a will which Imam wanted that to be in a written form. It is an advice, not a normal will that a person would die before he dies. This is in Nahjul Balagha also, where he called his family members. Initially, he addresses in the preamble his sons, Hassan and Hussein. And so it's in dual tense, where he says, you know, كُونَ لِلظَّالِمِ خَصْمًا وَلِلْمَظْلُومِ عَوْنًا. Referring to Hassan and Hussein, says, remember, you have to be opponent of the zalim, and you have to be the supporter of the mazlum. So this issue is very clear. We talk about adl. In our usul al-din, adl is an essential point, which is not there in other madhahib. All the way from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to anbiya and a'imma to the maraja and the mujtahideen, all the way to a simple, you know, imam of the Jamaat. We give importance to the issue of adl and justice. And the opposite of that is zulm. And so these fatawa are there, part of our teaching from day one. This is not a new ijtihad. This comes from the Quran and from the seerah of the Ahlul Bayt, alayhim salatu wassalam, salawat upon the Quran. Basikar hadith, Imam Hussain alayhi salam ka jab مکہ سے کربلا کی طرف جو سفر تھا امام جب اس منزل پہ پہنچے ہیں جہاں حور کے لشکر سے ملاقات ہوئی اس وقت حور کے لشکر کو امام نے دیکھا کہ یہ سب پیاسے ہیں ڈیٹیلز آپ کئی بار سن چکے ہیں کس طرح سے امام پہلے ہی ایکسٹرا پانی لے کے آئے تھے ایک منزل سے پہلے ہی صبح سب کو سیراب کیا اور وہ لوگ جا کے پھر اپنی جگہ جا کے سیٹل ہوئے ظہر کا وقت آیا ہو امام نے حور سے پوچھا کہ تم اپنے 1,000 سپاہی جو ہیں ان کے ساتھ نماز جماعت الگ قائم کرو گے یا ہمارے ساتھ شامل ہو گئے حور نے کہا کہ نہیں ہم لوگ عام لوگ آپ کے اقتداء میں نماز پڑھیں گے یہ پہلی علامت تھی کہ حور جو ہے باطنی طور پہ ایک مفسد شخص نہیں تھا یہ کسی حد تک حق اور باطل کو سمجھتا تھا ابھی تک اپورچونیٹی نہیں آئی تھی کہ جہاں اس کو فیصلہ کرنا پڑے امام نے ظہر کے بعد نماز کو لیڈ کیا اس کے بعد امام نے اس اپورچونیٹی کو دیکھتے ہوئے بہت ایک مختصر خطبہ بیان کیا اس وقت جس میں رسول اسلام کی ایک حدیث کو بیان کرتے ہیں جہاں فرماتے ہیں فقد علمت ان رسول اللہ صلی اللہ علیہ وآلہ وسلم تم جانتے ہو کہ رسول اسلام نے یہ کہا تھا من رعا سلطانا جائرا کہ ایک وہ شخص جو ایک جابر ظالم بادشاہ یا حکمران کو دیکھے مستحلاً لحرم اللہ جو اللہ کی حرمتوں کو پامال کرے نہ ناقصاً لعہد اللہ اللہ کے ساتھ جو عہد ہے حکمرانوں کا کہ وہ عدل و انصاف کے کام لیں گے اسے توڑ دے مخالفاً لسنت اللہ جو سنت الہی کی مخالفت کرے یعمل فی عباد اللہ بالاثم والعدیان جو لوگوں کے ساتھ جو ہے گناہ اور دشمنی کی بنیاد پر عمل کرے ثم لم یغیر وہ شخص جو ایسے بادشاہ کو جابر ظالم بادشاہ کو دیکھے اور ولم یغیر بفعل ولا قول اور عمل یا قول میں کوئی چینج نہ لائے تو خداوند عالم کان حقیقا علی اللہ یدخلہ مدخلہ تو پھر خدا کے لیے یہ حق بنتا ہے کہ وہ جو انڈیفرنٹ پرسن تھا اس کو اس جابر بادشاہ کے ساتھ رکھے قیامت میں تو یہ معاملہ ہے امام موسیٰ کاظم علیہ السلام کی حدیث میں بھی آپ نے دیکھا صفوان کے سلسلے میں اور امام حسین علیہ السلام نے بھی اس بات کو بالکل کلیئر کر دیا تھا اور اسی لیے آپ دیکھیں کہ جب ظالم و مظلوم کی بات ہوتی ہے ہمارا مذہب ہماری قوم ہمیشہ مظلومین کے ساتھ رہی ہے ظالم کے مخالف رہی ہے حالات پہ ڈپینڈ کرتا ہے کون کیا کرے ہم لوگ کی مصیبت یہ ہے نا کہ کچھ لوگ یہ سمجھتے ہیں دس از دی اونلی وے اف یو ڈونٹ ڈو دی وے آئی ایم ڈوئنگ تو پھر آپ جو ہیں ظالم کے مخالف نہیں ہیں یا مظلوم کے ساتھ نہیں ہیں بھائی سب کی الگ الگ ذمہ داری ہوتی ہے زید بن علی کی ذمہ داری کچھ اور تھی امام جعفر صادق کی ذمہ داری کچھ اور تھی حالات ایک ہی تھے زمانہ ایک تھا لیکن دونوں کی ذمہ داریاں الگ الگ تھیں لیکن بنیادی طور پہ جو مراحل ہیں قلبی طور پہ مظلوم کا ساتھ دینا ذہنی طور پہ مظلوم کا ساتھ دینا معلوماتی اعتبار سے مظلوم کا ساتھ دینا زبان کے اعتبار سے مظلوم کا ساتھ دینا مال کے ذریعے مظلوم کا ساتھ دینا مختلف طریقے ہیں جو ابھی بھی ہم یہاں بیٹھ کے فلسطین کے مظلوم ہیں جو ان کی حمایت کے لیے ہم کر سکتے ہیں تو مختلف طریقے ہیں مختلف ذمہ داریاں ہیں اس لنگ ایز آپ جس لیول پر بھی ہیں مظلوم کا جب ساتھ دیں گے تو آپ اللہ اور رسول اور امام کے ساتھ ہیں امام حسین علیہ السلام کی مظلومیت کو آپ دیکھ لیں کیوں ہمارے لیے یہ مشعل راہ ہیں کیوں ہم مسلم ان کی مظلومیت کو ہم نہیں بھولتے ہیں اس لیے کہ جب بھی ظلم کی بات ہوتی ہے جتنے مصائب سامنے آتے ہیں آپ کو ان تمام مصائب کا مجموعہ ایک جگہ ملے گا کربلا میں امام حسین علیہ السلام کے لیے پیاس کی بات ہے کل ہی رات کو ہم نے محفل میں کہا تھا کہ ایک بہت ہی پاورفل امیج تھا کسی نے ہمیں بھیجا تھا کہ مور دین اے بلین مسلمس کوڈ ناٹ ایون سینڈ ون بوٹل آف واٹر ٹو غزہ اسٹریپ سوچ لیں ہماری بدبختی کیا ہے بات پیاس کی ہے عاشور کے دن اگر کوئی سب سے زیادہ پیاسا تھا تو وہ ابا عبداللہ الحسین تھے اور یہ جو اذیت تھی اس کو جناب علی اکبر نے سب سے قریب سے محسوس کیا ہے جب حسین نے اپنی زبان دے دی تھی کہ بیٹا اپنے دہن میں رکھ لو اس سے تشفی نہیں ہوئی لیکن اب اکبر کو احساس ہو گیا کہ جتنے ہم پیاسے ہیں میرے بابا اس سے زیادہ پیاسے لیکن ساتھ ساتھ وہ چار سال کی بچی کو بھی احساس تھا کہ میرے بابا کتنے پیاسے ہیں اس لیے کہ حسین ابن علی کی شہادت واقع ہوئی ہے شہادت کے بعد اگر آپ دیکھیں جب گھوڑا آیا ہے دروازے خیموں کے پاس اور اہل حرم نے جب گھوڑے کی آواز سنی ہے دوڑتے ہوئے آئے دیکھنے کے لیے کیا مولا آگے ہے دیکھتے ہیں کہ گھوڑا موجود ہے لیکن حسین نہیں ہے وہاں جو گفتگو جناب سکینہ اور اس وفادار گھوڑے کی ہے وہ صرف ایک جملہ تھا کہا کہ اے اسب وفادار یہ بتاؤ کہ آخر وقت میں میرے بابا کو پانی نصیب ہوا یا نہ ہوا الا لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين سيعلم الذين ظلموا اي منقلب ينقلبون خدا وندا اس قلیل با قبول فرما ہمارے گناہوں کو معاف فرما ہماری توفیقات میں اضافہ فرما خدا وندا عالم اسلام جن مصیبت سے گزر رہا ہے خدا وندا اس میں امن و امان کی صورت حال پیدا کر خصوصاً غزہ اسٹرپ کے جو فلسطینی ہیں ان کو اپنے حفظ امان میں رکھ امام کے ظہور میں تعجل فرما ربنا تقبل منا انک انت السمیع العلیم